Hey everybody, this is Tracy here with another edition of A View from Tracy's Point, and we are here to recap Shots Fired Season 1. It was a series premiere, and when I tell you guys that I have been waiting for like a year for this show to come out, I think it was supposed to come out in the fall, but then they pushed it back to like a spring replacement, I guess that's what they call it. But anyway, this is the new show created by my girl, Gina Prince Bythewood, and her husband, Reggie. And you guys may be familiar with Gina. You know, she has a whole bunch of wonderful work, but my all-time favorite is Love and Basketball. And then she also did Beyond the Lights, I think was the name of the show with Nate Jacobs. But anyway, I was looking forward to this show and it did not disappoint. So let's go ahead and get started. The show is set in a small town in North Carolina, and it opens up with a tow truck pulling up and a black cop shooting a white guy in what looks like a predominantly black neighborhood. And he calls for backup, and interestingly, all the backup that shows up are white police officers. When they tell the crowd to back up away from the scene and away from the body and everything that's going on, then the camera pans out on the crowd, and then you have all these black guys and they're standing there with their hands up. A homage to Mike Brown and the hands up, don't shoot movement. So this is the first episode, so guys forgive me if I get some of these characters and names wrong. But the scene goes to a baseball game, and it's a guy, you know, he's up to bat and he hits the ball, and then it kind of zooms in, I think, when the screen gets smaller, and it was actually three guys in the office that were watching this game on television. And so it turns out that it is a guy named Julian Carroll, who's an older white guy, a guy named Preston Terry, who's a younger black guy, and then there was one other white guy in the room. And so they are federal prosecutors in the Civil Rights Division, and Carroll is the head of the unit, I guess. And so he tells the guys that the Department of Justice has called for a federal probe into the shooting, and that Preston is being assigned the task of getting to the bottom of what happened. And so he's a young guy fresh out of college, you know, eager to go save the world. So that's how he pretty much gets assigned this case. And so I think they strategically place him over the case because he's a young black guy. And then the cop that is accused of shooting the unarmed guy, he was also black. So Carol pretty much tells Preston to go clear the cop, you know, but Preston lets him know that he takes his oath seriously and states that he will do the job with integrity because, quote, my truth has no color, unquote. So Ash Aquino, which is played by Sanaa Lathan, and she must be like the angry black woman that we seem to have on every show nowadays. So she has a daughter by a Latino guy named Javier, and she is at Javier and his girlfriend's place, and I guess she's saying goodbye to the daughter because we learned that she's going to be a part of this investigation. And so the girlfriend comes in, and she's also a Latino, and she's like yelling at the kids about going to bed or something. So once the kids leave the room, Ash gets up in her face and tells her, you know, don't be yelling at her kids. So these two go back and forth, and then she ends up throwing a vase at the lady. So I'm thinking, okay, Ash has some anger management issues. So then Javier comes in the room, and he pulls Ash outside and tells her that she really needs to check herself and stop being mean to his girlfriend because she doesn't mean any harm. So Ash, then in the next scene, we have Ash and she's with Preston and they're at the airport, and he immediately lets her know that he is her boss. And so, you know, she's like, whoa, you know, well, excuse me. So then this is, I guess, going to be like the good cop versus the bad cop type situation going on. So then a aide from the governor's office comes up and she meets with them and introduces herself, and she tells them that the governor wants to speak to them. And so she leads them outside to a waiting SUV. The governor's name is Patricia Emmons, and she lets them know that she wants things wrapped up quickly and pretty and neatly. She don't want no mess in her town, you know, any riots breaking out or anything. So as she's speaking, it's apparent that she doesn't have much respect for Ash because she's like talking directly to present, and I hate when people do that, like when there's another person sitting in the room or in their presence, but they're kind of like blatantly ignoring the other person. So, Ash is in the back of the SUV, and you can tell that she's kind of feeling, some kind of way. So Preston and Ash, they go to the police station when they arrive in town, and the camera pans around the predominantly white force. And so everyone is looking at them like, what the hell are they doing here, walking around freely without handcuffs and not being interrogated? So in with Deputy Joshua Beck, which is the black police officer. Ash shares her experience of her first shooting, and she lets him know that she was wrestling with the suspect and that it was a young guy. And her partner, or the guy who was training her, he yells out to her that the guy had a gun, so she shoots him. And then she realizes that he was only 17 years old, he was unarmed, and what he had was actually a cell phone. And so she was cleared of any wrongdoing because she proved that she was legitimately fearing for her life. You get where we're going with this, right? Role reversals, but the same scene, same scenario. Then Deputy Beck explains that, it was a routine traffic stop, and that he asked the victim, whose name I think it was Jesse Carr, to get out of the vehicle, and that when he was getting out of the car, that Jesse reached for his gun, and at some point he had his hand actually on the gun, but somehow Beck got the gun away from him, pulled it out, and shot him four times. And then he says that when they searched the car, that the guy had marijuana in the car. And then Preston asked him, was that before or after the shooting? And he says that they found the marijuana after the shooting. Isn't that how it always works? So it turns out that they were racially profiling the car guy because he was white and he was traveling in a black neighborhood, which according to Deputy Beck means that he was looking for trouble. And then Beck shuts down and asks for a union rep when Preston begins questioning him, about the whole profiling thing. So outside, Ash tells Preston, that his interview style was a rookie move, and that going forward, she's the one that needs to be doing all the interviews. And so I think I forgot to mention that Preston is the lead prosecutor in the case, and then Ash is the investigator. So I guess she's the one that's actually supposed to be questioning people and determining, which way that they're going to go to get the evidence that they need for the case. So over at the crime scene, Preston and Ash, they talk to witnesses, and it's all fun and games because the citizens of this community can't believe that they are the ones that's leading the investigation. So then the kid rides up on his bike, and his name was Clay. So then Clay lets them know that the reason no one is answering their questions is because they aren't asking the right questions. So two cop cars pull up at the end of the road, and then all the witnesses get nervous and they walk away from Preston and Ash. So Ash and Preston go to talk with the victim's mom. Her name is Alicia, and she is reasonably angry, that her son was killed. And so she says that her son didn't do drugs, and that he would never pull a gun on anyone, let alone the police, and that he was a great kid. And she's ironing a shirt, and she says that, if he was still alive, he would never wear that shirt. But she had to go and buy something to bury him in because all he owned was t-shirts. And so Preston expresses his sympathy for her loss, but she says that her son was not lost, he was murdered. The scene moves over to the home of Deputy Beck, and there's an activist there by the name of Pastor Janae James. And she is there speaking to him and his wife Carrie about attending a meeting or rally, that she's organized at her church, and she wants, to give him the opportunity to tell his side of the story to the community, but of course they can't attend the rally. So the governor holds a press conference, and she gives the typical statements, as she introduces Preston as the lead prosecutor. And the reporters, they're asking the same stupid questions that they always ask at these press conferences. So Pastor Janae, she's in the crowd, and she wants to know why they sent black prosecutors to invest the shooting when black men are killed by white cops all the time and nothing is ever done. So Preston, he gives a speech, and it's kind of like a I call it a Martin Luther King speech. You know, I have a dream and I'm here to do all these great things and to bring justice and make sure that everyone is treated equally and fairly and yada, 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 yada. And so he lets them know that he admits that it looks like, you know, the government has sent in the cavalry, you know, because it was a black cop killing a white guy, but he's there to seek justice and race doesn't matter. And he says that although the crowd sees race as the issue, he's just there to seek justice. So the governor's aide comes over after he finishes his speech and lets him know that he just made her life a living hell, you know, by getting up there and saying what he said. Then Ash and Preston, they're at the bar and she lets him know that she was surprised by his speech. And so he tells her that she hasn't known him long enough or know him well enough to be surprised by anything that he does. And so she also tells him that she thought he was gay when they first met. And I'm like, Lord help us, how you just walk up to the man and tell him, like, what about him made her think that he was gay? But I guess it's because he's all, you know, well-spoken, college-educated and all that stuff. And so, you know, he lets her know that he's anything but gay and asks her, you know, he said something to her. I can't remember what it was. But then her response was that she is every man's type, you know, because she's all that in a bag of chips. And so he lets her know that Michelle Obama is his type. So they agree to get along and then they begin to talk about the shooting incident that she had shared with Deputy Beck at the beginning of the show. So Ash then asked him if he believed half of what he said in that speech, and then when he was getting ready to get up and leave, he turned around and told her, yes, half. So we don't know what half of the speech he really believed. Was it the part that he was there for justice or the part that race doesn't matter? We'll know. We'll find that later. So Preston goes back to the neighborhood to look for Clay, and granted, it's late at night and he don't know nothing about these people, but you know, he finds Clay and Clay tells him that he needs to go to the house that has the camera in front of it. And so he's like, well, what house? And then Clay gets on his bicycle and Preston follows in his car. So when they get to the house, you know, he tells Preston that it's, the house number is 308, and then he rides off. So when Preston is crossing the street, two guys come and they jump him and beat him up. So the following day, when Ash learns Preston went looking for Clay, she is pissed off and tells him to stop doing her job. So she decides to go to the house and talk to the woman who lives there. And the woman's name is Shamika Campbell, and she lets them in, you know, when they say that they are with the Department of Justice. But Shamika, you know, she's really enamored with Preston, you know, but then Ash goes full throttle and the lady shuts down, but she lets them know that she didn't know that they were there to talk about the white kid that was killed. She thought they were there to investigate her son who was killed. And so when, you know, Ash realizes that the lady has experienced the loss, she changes her, you know, her tone and tones it down. It turns out that her son was killed a couple of weeks earlier, but nothing was ever done about it and there wasn't really an investigation. But she shares that the police came to her house and they were threatening her, and then they searched her son's room, you know, without a search warrant or anything, and claimed that they found marijuana. They always have marijuana, remember that. And that, you know, it was in his room, and that if she talked to the police or anything, you know, that they could charge her with drug possession. And then they also threatened to remove her other children from the home if she just didn't let everything die down and let it go. Then she also shared that the people in the neighborhood told her that the police were involved with her son's death, but she could never get any additional information. As they leave the house, Preston and Ash are at odds, you know, about what they should do with the information. You know, of course, as she wants to go in gung-ho and figure out what's going on, who killed the boy and everything else, you know, now she's like more concerned about the Campbell boy than she is about the car boy that was killed, and which is the reason that they were there. And then Preston is like, we are here to do a job, we're here to investigate the car shooting, and let's stick to that. But she wants to know how they can, you know, intertwine and investigate both of them. So Ash shows up at the police department later that evening, and there are a couple of cops coming out. You know, they're getting off for the day, and so she asks them where's choir practice. And then next thing we know, they're at a bar and they're having drinks together. So it's all laughs until she starts asking them questions, you know, about the community and about the shooting. So then they turn the tables on her and ask her about her officer-involved shooting and how is it that she killed an unarmed teen and still has a job. So Ash, you know, she asks about the neighborhood where the shooting takes place again, and suddenly a process server walks up and serves her with papers, and it seems that Javier is now seeking full custody of their daughter. In her car, you know, we have Ash, and she's on the phone with Javier, and she's pleading with him, you know, to drop the case and to give her another chance. And she tells him that, you know, she loves her daughter, and her daughter is all she has, and she's the only thing that makes sense in her life. But he tells her that he has to do what's best for the daughter, and her, you know, mood swings and outbursts, and the job that she's doing is more harmful to the daughter. And so, you know, he thinks that him and his girlfriend could do a better job raising her. Preston and Ash, they meet with Preston's brother, Maceo, who is a professional baseball player. So I guess that's who they were watching at the beginning of the show when they were watching the game. And so he wants to get some get back, you know, for Preston getting jumped when he was over in that neighborhood. And then he and Ash, you know, they start flirting with each other for a few minutes. And then Preston kind of diverts the attention back to the brother. And they get into like a little back and forth spat about who's more socially conscious or more awake or woke. Is it awake or awoke? But anyway, so then Preston tells the brother that, you know, making these little tweets out to his 1 million followers is not being socially conscious. And the brother lets him know that it's 1.4 million or something like that. So anyway, Preston decides to leave, but Ash says that she's staying because she's going to eat this $50 steak that's sitting in front of her. We have Preston, and he's back at the hotel where they're staying, and he's knocking on the door of a room. And so it's the governor's aide who opens the door, and he's standing there with a bottle of wine. So she lets him in, and I'm like, okay, well, damn, that was real quick. Like, y'all just met the day before. So after they have sex, it seems that she has buyer's remorse because a video has leaked of Deputy Beck, which I guess it was when he was first made it onto the, I guess it's not the police force, it's the sheriff's. Deputies work for the county and they're usually with the sheriff's department. So anyway, when he got his job, he was like at a barbecue or something with the homies where he said that, you know, he was going to take these bullets and shoot some white people or something. Like, there's always a video that leaks showing, you know, racist tendencies or prejudices of these people that kill these unarmed people. So anyway, they're just being, you know, accurate with the portrayal of what went down. It's just the role reversals, you know, as far as the black and the white situation. But I like where they're going with it. So back at the restaurant, Ash and Maceo have, you know, come outside and look like they were in a limousine or something. So Ash is flirting with him and he tells her, you know, that she better watch out, you know, because if he smashes her, that he won't respect her in the morning. And then Ash says that she doesn't need to be respected in the morning. And then Maceo lets her know, but I think I really like you and I may be falling for you. And then Ash tells him that he's acting like a bitch. So the last thing you want to do is call a brother a bitch. And next thing I know, he gives her what she wants right there in the back of the car. And I'm just like, dang. Ooh, they just sure be making black folks look like all they about is sex, sex, sex. No feelings, no emotions, no connections, no love, no nothing. We just like some wild savages that just screw any and everybody anywhere the mood hits. At the hotel the following morning, or maybe it was later that night, who knows, Ash runs into Preston as he's leaving the aide's room, and they discuss the case briefly, and then she asks him, you know, since he's a lawyer, you know, can he tell her how does a person prove a, like in a custody case, like how does the father prove that the mother is not fit to care for the child or something like that. And so he lets her know that basically he would have to prove that she's unfit and that the child is not safe with that parent and that, you know, they provide a better environment. And then he tells her that, you know, last night didn't mean anything. And I guess he was referring to Maceo, or maybe he meant the aide, I don't know who he was referring to, but then Ash replies that it didn't mean anything to her either. And I'm just shaking my tail head like, okay. Anyway, let's move on. So it's the day of the rally at Pastor Janae's church. And so she calls up Shamika Campbell, you know, and of course the audience, they applaud her. They're happy to see her. And then she calls up Alicia Carr, you know, and the people are looking at her like, why is this white woman in here? But she lets them know that both of them share the same pain because they both lost their sons, and that the community has to unite to get justice for both of them, regardless of their race. And so the mothers embrace and the audience begins to applaud. Then Ash gets a call because her and Preston were at the rally also. And so she gets a call and she steps out. And then when she comes back, she says that it was Carol and that he was giving them a heads up that he had talked to the governor or something. And she was talking so low that I couldn't hear what it was that the governor wants them to do, but I'm thinking maybe she wanted them to follow up on both of the cases instead of just focusing on the car case. So the show ends with Preston and he's in a batting cage, you know, practicing hitting. So I'm thinking like maybe him and his brother were good baseball players, but the brother made it to the pros, whereas he went on to pursue being a lawyer. And then Ash is in her room and she's pinning pictures to the wall. And then Deputy Beck, you know, he's sitting on his bed and he's looking at the obituary for the Campbell boy. And I think I thought it said his name was Troy, but then when I was looking up the names of the characters, I came across a Joey Campbell. So maybe it said Joey Campbell. And then it's nighttime and Clay is being chased by several cars while he's on his bicycle. And then he eventually jumps off the bicycle and starts running on foot. And then whoever was driving the cars, they jump out of the cars and start chasing him on foot. And they're like running through the neighborhood, jumping fences and running through bushes and everything. And then he finally ends up underneath the house. And so the show goes off and we don't really know if he lost them or if they're going to find him, but he's like under the house scared and he's looking out. And so that was it. And like I said, it was an awesome, awesome, awesome series premiere. And I can't wait to follow this show. And I'm interested to see how people receive it because earlier today I was on social media and I had found a story about it. And no, it wasn't a story about it. I was looking for the preview, like one of the videos of the preview of the show, because I want to post it on my Facebook page, A View from Tracy's Point. So if you're on Facebook, please like the page, A View from Tracy's Point. And people were making some very harsh and racist comments underneath the YouTube video of the preview. And so I thought that was really sad. And, you know, they were angry that Fox was making the show. And then I didn't get a chance to go on Twitter to see like what the comments were under the hashtag shots fired. But anyway, leave your comments below and let me know what you think about the show. Are you going to be watching and tuning in? Are you excited about it? Please, no racist comments, no angry, you know, talk about the show, talk about the recap. There's no need to express your views about different races and different cultures because they will be deleted. So go ahead, you know, like I say, leave your comments, but be nice about it. Rate the video, subscribe to the channel if you haven't done so already, and I will chat with you guys later. Bye-bye.